Friday, and for RPM tonight, that means the racing action is kicking into high gear. The NASCAR Winston Cup and Busch Series roll for the pole at the track Too Tough to Tame. The Indy Racing League heads back out to the desert to swing back into action after a two-month break. And the air is right in Houston, so the NHRA expects the records to fall. That and a lot more coming your way next.
Hello, everyone. I'm John Kernan. We begin RPM tonight with some sad news. John Nemechek passed away Friday morning as a result of uncontrollable brain swelling, secondary to the severe brain injuries he suffered in a crash during Sunday's Truck Series race at Homestead, Florida.
John Nemechek turned 27 years old just 4 days before the crash at Homestead, Florida that would eventually end his life. The younger brother of Winston Cup regular Joe Nemechek was just getting his racing career started in the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series. John had made 43 starts in the trucks. His best finish, ironically, came at Homestead in 1996 when he drove to a seventh-place finish. But John always believed that he had the talent to make it to the top.
We've been running up near the top 10. Just tedious things just take us out, but we're a very strong team. I'm a strong driver, and everybody's just backing me 100 to 110%, and one day the show's going to turn around and we're really going to really do good.
Nemechek grew up in Florida and raced motorcycles before moving up to the NASCAR Winston Racing Series in the Carolina, Virginia region. He enjoyed fishing when not concentrating on racing. Nemechek was not married.
Funeral services are scheduled for Monday in Lakeland, Florida. NASCAR President Bill France said he was deeply saddened to hear of John's passing. France says the NASCAR community will miss John Nemechek.
It's a sad day, especially for the Nemechek family. You know, I've been around a long time in racing, and I don't know of a family any closer than those people are. And this is I talked to Joe several times, and, you know, his 27-year-old brother, and he's now gone, and Joe's having a tough time with it, but, you know, they're a very religious family, and I'm sure the good Lord is going to help them put it together, and they'll be okay.
It's really a terrible thing. I got a lot of respect for his mother and father, and John. You know, we always got along good. I tried to help him along, you know, when he was more or less a rookie like everybody else was at the time, and I see a lot of my mom and his mom, so it's a pretty tough thing on me.
It's a reminder of how dangerous this sport can be. It's a great sport, and it really is safe, and that was just a bad freak accident. But our best wishes go to the Nemechek family right now.
Understandably, Joe Nemechek will not race at Darlington this weekend. He is with his family. NASCAR Busch Series driver Phil Parsons will drive Joe's car in this weekend's race. And Parsons posted a lap at 168.348 miles an hour during his qualifying run in Joe's car. That was 29th fastest overall. Dale Jarrett won the pole last summer at Darlington. He's fastest again, 171.095. It was Bobby Labonte leading the way for the Pontiac Brigade at 170.910 miles an hour. He starts third on Sunday. Another good run for Jeff Bodine. He grabbed the fourth starting spot with a lap of 170.744. Now watch Gary Bradbury as he comes out of turn four. He almost tags the wall, but hangs on to earn the 14th starting position. Ricky Craven had a shot at the pole, but he just misses it and will start second, 171.047 miles an hour. Surprising run for Dale Earnhardt, 40th fastest in qualifying, just over 167. But perhaps the biggest surprise of the day came from Mike Wallace. He's 17th fastest, 168.816. Mike smiling, but not as big as Jarrett. He wins the pole and is with Bill Weber.
Well, Dale Jarrett is on a remarkable roll, and now you're in the Busch Clash and on the pole here again at Darlington. Congratulations.
Thank you, thank you. It doesn't get much better than this. To win here at Darlington, the pole, is a special feeling. Two in a row now, and went for so many years and couldn't hardly get in the top 10, and now these guys have put me on the pole again, so we're excited. Front's the place to be here to start with. Can run the race that you want to run, and that's important for us.
They're going to change this track around, but we don't care about that right now. It's a tough place to race no matter which way you're going.
Doesn't make any difference where we start this race. It's going to be tough. They can't do enough to make it any worse than what it is. It's a tough racetrack, but a fun racetrack. It's such a challenge for the driver. Getting around here two laps in a row the same way is a challenge, and trying to go 400 miles is even more. So we look forward to that challenge on Sunday.
Your luck here last year wasn't very good. You ran out of gas one time and kind of brushed the wall the other time.
Yeah, that hasn't, but we ran well, and that's the key, is we know we can run well here. We just have to finish it off and be there at the end on Sunday, and then we can get ourselves into victory lane.
Okay, that's Dale Jarrett. He's on the pole, and he's the points leader.
Jared beat Craven for the pole by just 0.008 of a second. Mark Martin and his Roush Racing teammate Jeff Burton qualified 5th and 6th. They were separated by 0.066 of a second. Craven wasn't so sure about a great run after watching his teammate Jeff Gordon qualify.
My pal Jeff, he was fastest in practice, and he slipped a little bit, and that had me concerned, you know. But Budweiser Chevrolet is good. I'm real excited about Sunday.
I think a lot of it goes back to, you know, Joe Gibbs Racing puts together a really good race team, you know, and I'm very fortunate I get to drive it because I get the fun part of it, and those other guys get skinned knuckles and stuff like that.
Well, I knew I got through turn one and two really good, and I just was a little conservative in three and four. I might have left the pole out there. The car stuck really good. It was fast. It didn't wiggle. It just went where I needed it to go, and so maybe could have gone a little faster, but you don't get second chances. We'll have to try again next week.
We went into qualifying hoping to just be in the top 25. The car hadn't felt good to me all day. I don't know if I just ignored it or what it was, but I just didn't have a good feel of the car all day. The team kept working on it, kept making changes. It's a tribute to them that we're going to end up in the top 10 because our car was nowhere near a top 10 car.
Hud Strickland, who finished second at the Southern 500 last year, Darlington lines up 7th this Sunday. Jeff Gordon had been fastest in practice. He winds up 10th on the grid. Then it's Lake Speed and Terry Labonte, but it's Strickland who says, look out come Sunday.
We've done some things to tighten the car up before the last practice was over and everything. We didn't quite go enough. It was, I think, a racetrack loosened up on us or something. But I tell you, we got a killer good car for Sunday. Pretty decent lap. You know, there's a lot of mistakes that, you know, I can look at now and say, man, I wish I'd done a little bit different, but I think it's going to be a good, solid run.
Well, we wanted to run faster, but we got a little loose in three and four and had a real good turns, one and two speed, but got loose up there, just tried too hard, and the clouds was out. By the time we went, the sun popped out, and, you know, might have hurt us a little bit, but, them forwards going to be hard to handle.
I got real loose off of two, and I was lucky just to have the car not spin out and hit the wall, so... I'm pretty happy with the lap that we had, considering, you know, what happened out there. But we certainly are capable of much, much more than that.
Really kind of got bobbled down there in turn one. I tried, got in the corner a little bit too deep, then wound up using a little bit too much brake. Slowed down, you know, you overcompensated a little bit. But all in all, like I said, it's good when you mess up and you're still 11.
Ken Schrader heads up the next listed qualifier, starting from the 13th position with a lap of 169.561 miles an hour. David Green posted the fastest lap for a rookie at 168.729 miles an hour to grab the 22nd starting spot. Derek Cope gets the final qualifying spot of the day, 168.654. It's been almost 2 months since the Indy Racing League ran its last race. On Friday, they fired the engines up for practice as race weekend got underway at the Phoenix International Raceway. An anxious moment for Roberto Guerrero. He made some contact with the wall in the afternoon practice session. He was okay. Buddy Lazier pushed his Infiniti-powered Dallara to just over 159 miles an hour. Last year's winner at Phoenix, Ari Leyendijk, looks pretty racy again this year, almost 161 miles an hour. But as usual, Tony Stewart is the man, fastest by 5 miles an hour at almost 166. Jim Guthrie posted the second fastest lap in the first round of practice at almost 162 miles an hour. Fermin Velez and Robbie Buell were neck to neck in practice. Then it was Buzz Calkins and Scott Goodyear to round out the top six. Everyone says the heat really slowed him down.
What happens is the warmer it gets, the more the car loses its downforce. So the wings are not as effective. So the car will start sliding around on you. So the speeds will drop dramatically when it gets warmer.
I think everybody's probably caught off by this real hot weather that's going on right now. A few people came and tested here maybe a week or so ago when it was warm and maybe a bit of an advantage. But we'll get it fixed up and changed up, but I think we'll be there. We'll be strong.
As long as you're moving in the race car, the heat's fine for you as a driver. But in terms of what it does to the track conditions and how it affects the tires, we'll still have to see how that kind of takes shape.
I think that is going to be the biggest story of the weekend, and it's just going to be, I think there's a lot of guys that can go quick, you know, in the cooler temperatures, but that's not going to work in the warm temperatures, and especially for the race. And so I think this race is going to be hard on tires, it's going to be hard on engines, and so it's really, again, I think it's going to be a thing of reliability.
We look back at more of the top speeds from Friday's first round of practice. Leyendijk was 7th fastest at almost 161 miles an hour. Buddy Lazier was 9th fastest, by the way, while Guerrero was 12th fastest at 157.846 miles an hour. Practice for the NHRA Slick 50 Nationals got underway out in Houston, Texas on Friday. Two of the big stories, Al Hoffman and John Force. And, of course, Dave McClelland has the latest.
John, the big story from the Slick 50 Nationals here at Houston Raceway Park is a change in body styles on Winston champion John Force's funny car. John, explain to us what prompted the move.
Oh, we just simplify it. Everyone knows Tony was in a Mustang at the beginning of the season, and it was just a parting of the way, just a good old-fashioned separation.
You have had great success with the GM products over the years. I'm sure that there's little change, at least performance-wise, in the body.
Well, there's a little bit difference, but Tony's cars run 300, just like the Pontiac, and he's running the fours with it. So it's going to be fine. I think we're going to get some wind tunnel time to make some improvements, but I'm excited to make the switch. It's going to mix everything up out here a little bit, but like I say, it was like a marriage. I'm just moving on to a new one, but behind, I got a lot of friends at General Motors. I love them to death. They were good to me a lot of years.
You know, one of the big stories that came out of Gainesville 2 weeks ago was the winner of Funny Car Competition, Al Hoffman, suffered a giant engine explosion right in the lights when he won the race. And here he is 2 weeks later. Are you driving this weekend?
Well, we were going to try to, but things aren't quite going our way, so I'm putting Jeff Arend in the car here, and he's a good little driver, and I think we got a fast car. If we can come out here and win this thing, you know, we couldn't ask for much more.
What's the doctor say about your injuries?
Well, he said I should be completely healed in 8 weeks. Right at the point now, I'm going to try to drive in Rockingham. There's no points there, but one way or the other, my car will be there, but I'll definitely be in Atlanta driving.
Any kind of long-term prognosis on the status of him? You're going to have use of both hands and all?
Yeah, he said everything should be right there 100%. The left hand is already, you know, fine. I mean, it got cut up a little bit, and I've got, you know, just about total mobility of it, so I've got no problem with that. If it wasn't for the cast on the right arm right now, I mean, it really wouldn't be a problem driving. So we're looking forward to getting back in there.
We look forward to seeing you on the racetrack. Al Hoffman recuperating from the injury suffered 2 weeks ago. John, that's the story from Houston Raceway Park in the Slick 50 Nationals.
Thank you, Dave. Forrest hasn't missed a beat despite the switch. He was quickest in first-round qualifying, 5.055 ET. In pro stocks, it was Warren Johnson with an elapsed time of 6.994. They're expecting a 200-mile-an-hour top speed when the temps cool later on. And in pro stock bikes, Angel Seeling was quickest to 7.402. That is a new track record. Later on RPM tonight, another big day for the Diamond Ridge NASCAR Busch Series team. And despite a disappointing qualifying run, the Richard Childers crew has high hopes for this weekend. Near the 169-mile-an-hour mark last week at Darlington, on Friday, with the newest rules change, Rick was just 42nd fastest, lap at 167.186 miles an hour. Also failing to qualify in the first round are Jimmy Spencer and Michael Waltrip. John Andretti was 33rd fastest, while Robbie Gordon posted just the 38th quickest time. Now, these drivers on the last page will have to decide whether to re-qualify or try to make the field through a provisional starting spot. Well, of course, Friday at Darlington turned out to be a day of mixed emotions for the teams getting ready to race this weekend. We go back to the track for more from Bill Weber.
Well, as you can certainly imagine, this one of the most difficult days to spend at the racetrack. During Winston Cup practice on Friday morning, many teams paused for an individual moment of silence, and several said prayers for the Nemechek family. But racing continues, and the first order of business for Team Sabco was to find someone to fill Joe Nemechek's seat until he could return to the track. That man is Phil Parsons.
I hate to be in the car under these circumstances, but you know, I'm sure it was important for Joe to be with his family, so I'm just glad to help out.
Among the candidates to go to Victory Lane here on Sunday, Jeff Gordon, looking for his third win of the season and his fourth straight at Darlington. Meanwhile, nine-time Darlington winner Dale Earnhardt hasn't won in 31 races. But this week, he has a car that crew chief Larry McReynolds is much more familiar with.
My goal when I went to Richards in December was to go in there and see what was there and work with what was there, because obviously a lot of success has come out of those shops over the number of years in the past. But you know, after running three or four races, certainly got to be careful, because I don't think what they had was wrong. It's just something that I wasn't used to working on. That's the thing about racing. There's not one right way and 100 wrong ways. There's probably 100 right ways to do something. So it's just got me back close to what I'm used to working on. Our guys at the shop have worked their guts out to get this car done, just to try to make it as good as we can, because contrary to people's belief, Dale Earnhardt has still got it.
Well, we've really not had a lot of success here. If you look at, yeah, we've got three wins, but then look at the rest of our finishes. So it just says about how tough this place is. If you come here expecting to win the race, you're going to end up 23rd, 24th.
Darlington can be tough enough for experienced drivers, but try being a rookie like Tim Steele in the Busch Series. Still, the defending ARCA champ is happy with his new ride and has some modest goals set for this season.
Still all new to me and still, you know, can't really believe that this has all happened, and
and all the changes that, you know, are made with my shop and driving here. I guess you could say this is the first real job I've ever had.
When we return to Darlington in the fall, the front stretch will be the back stretch, and the back stretch will be the front stretch. Actually, the only thing they're going to change is where they put the official starter, Doyle Ford. One other thing that doesn't change very much at this track, tire wear. And it will be a big factor here this weekend.
Next on RPM Tonight, a new car for Mark Martin. We'll let you know how he did in Busch Series qualifying when we come back. First start on the front row for a NASCAR Busch Series race. Well, the dynamic duo did it again on Friday at Darlington. We head out to the track for qualifying. Tim Steele in the four car the rest of the year. He qualified 21st fastest. A new ride also for Dennis Setzer starting this weekend. He starts 37th in the 43 car after qualifying at almost 160 and a half. Last week, Jeff Green won the pole. This week, he's second quickest, a lap of 165.186 miles an hour. On the pole, it's Elliott Sadler with a lap at 29.615 seconds. That's 166.051 miles an hour. Sadler beating his teammate by almost a whole mile an hour to win the top starting spot. Ricky Craven qualified in the third spot, but his car did not pass the post-qualifying inspection, so he will have to start the race last. For Sadler, it marked his second pole of the year.
But in the front row last week in Las Vegas, he beat me for that, and then I beat him this week, so pretty good fun going on between the two teams, but as long as we're both up front and the car's in one piece, we'll call a successful day.
I think I left a little bit out there in 3 and 4, but, you know, I don't want to bring it back here on the hook, so it was better to run second to Elliott than bring it back on the hook. It's going to be a long day tomorrow. Be a lot of sliding around, you know, and who can slide the best is going to win this race.
I don't think the temperature-wise done anything, but whenever they cool these cars down and stuff like that, we had run an 03 out there in practice, and we wasn't cooled down. So I knew I had a little bit left there just from cooling it down. It's just if I hit my line out there on the racetrack. But everybody should have picked up, and like I say, it's showing it on the racetrack.
Dick Trickle starts Saturday's Diamond Hill Plywood 200 from the seventh position. He's followed by Hermie Sadler, Todd Bodine, Mark Green, Randy LaJoie, and Lyndon Amick. LaJoie in a much better spot than last week when he wrecked, and Randy says today's lap could have been faster.
I left some out there. Darlington's one of my favorite racetracks, but it can bite you in a hurry. So we're in the top 10 legitimately. I'm not sure if I could have run a 70, but I think I could have run an 80, but I came back. I didn't do that last week.
I won't say we're disappointed. That's exactly what we ran in practice. We felt like we were going to run a little faster, and the car was just a little too loose to get after it real hard.
The way things have gone, everywhere I expected to run good, we hadn't run very well, and the tracks that are tough, we seem to have gotten around pretty good. But I like Darlington, and we've always run good here, just never finished good here, so maybe this is the week.
Diamond Ridge is going to be tough. They got very good motors, and they got a couple good drivers, too, so I don't care. Bring them on. I'm ready.
Jason Keller and LaJoie's teammate Tim Fedewa make up the seventh row for Saturday's Busch Series race. Phil Parsons is second in the points. He rolls off in the 15th spot. Ted Musgrave is driving the Doug Taylor on number 40 Ford. Ted starts 19th. Steve Park is 22nd, followed by Tim Bender, Tracy Leslie, and Mike McLaughlin. When we come back, we head back out to the desert where it just might turn out to be Tony Stewart's weekend. Tonight with a look at more Friday's practice speeds for the IRL out in Phoenix. Eddie Cheever, who won at Orlando 2 months ago, was 17th fastest. Scott Sharp, you'll recall, had been very fast in the test in the West a couple of weeks ago, but he had some problems and was well back 22nd quickest. Now, when the IRL runs its 200-mile race at Phoenix this Sunday, a lot of people will be keeping an eye on the reliability of those new engines. And as Marlo Klain reports, one of the top teams had some engine problems as practice opened on Friday.
Scott Sharp's morning practice was cut short. After just 5 laps on the track, he blew his engine. In response, team owner A.J. Foyt brought in his teammate, Davey Hamilton, as a precautionary measure.
We had really good oil pressure, so A.J. wanted to go back and find out exactly why the motor blew and didn't want to take a chance at blowing the other car. And we were fortunate that I really wasn't up to speed that much yet and then blew it, so there was no risk there of damaging the car or anything, but he wanted to make sure the second car was okay.
We really haven't found a problem with Scott's car, and there may not have been one, just may have been a chance of the motor, you know, not being assembled right or one little mistake or who knows what, but in my car, everything looks good so far.
The Infinities continued their pursuit of the Aurora engine. Buddy Luzier ran limited laps to conserve his engine, as did Roberto Guerrero. The Nissans tested here a couple of weeks ago, and a company spokesman said the test was a catastrophic failure, but the company thinks they have isolated the problem.
the positive side is that every time we go out, there are improvements. So hopefully they'll keep doing those improvements really fast, and then we'll be able to catch up. It's been a little frustrating because the reliability hasn't been there either. So it's hard to work with the chassis and whatever. But you know, it's just something that we just have to wait and hope that it gets better soon.
One driver who doesn't have any trouble finding speed is Tony Stewart. The Team Menard driver was 4 miles an hour faster than anyone else in the field this morning.
The temperature is about 30 degrees hotter now than it was when we were testing here, so I think it's kind of thrown everybody off a little bit, but we feel like we've adjusted for the temperature a little better than everyone else has. I think my experience with the midgets and Silver Crown cars here has helped me. I know what to expect when this track gets hot, so hopefully we'll just stay ahead of the racetrack the rest of the weekend.
I think right now we're just a little bit ahead, but this is just the first practice session. We weren't the fastest out here in the testing, and I'm sure Foyt and some of the other teams are going to have something to say about this when it's all over.
While Tony Stewart's IRL winless streak continues, he does know where the winner's circle is here at PIR. In January, he piloted his midget car to victory in the Copper World Classic. In Phoenix, Marlo Klein, RPM Tonight.
Check out this Radio Shack Fast Fact, and we'll be right back in a moment. Works, the NASCAR Busch Series race at Darlington highlights Saturday's schedule. Sunday, we've got the NASCAR Winston Cup Series at Darlington, the IRL at Phoenix, and the NHRA live from Houston. A federal court jury ruled on Friday that manufacturers of a plane that crashed and killed Alan Kulwicki and three others were not negligent. The jury awarded no damages to the Insurance Company of North America, Eastern Foods, and Hooters of America. The National Transportation Safety Board said the pilot of the plane had failed to use the engine inlet anti-ice system, and ice was sucked into the engines, causing them to fail. In Top Fuel, first-round qualifying out at Houston for the Slick 50 Nationals, 94 Rookie of the Year, Bob Vandergriff Jr., a new ET track record, 4.63 seconds. He reached a top speed of 300.4 miles an hour. Well, enjoy the racing this weekend, and we will be back again Monday night at 7 Eastern to talk all about it. The professor, Benny Parsons, is going to be here. We'll see you then. Good night, everybody.